So who hasn't had the dream of the big trade? That trade that is so, you've worked on it, you've built the theory around it, you applied, you studied, you back tested. It's the trade you want to share at cocktail parties to explain the new Lamborghini in the driveway trade. Do you have one of those? Have you ever wanted one of those? Well, I want one of those, and I am so into the macro and into the long trade, the long game. And most importantly, it's the adventure of getting from here to there. It's not necessarily the win, but it's the adventure of getting there and testing and figuring and thinking and constantly working on this idea. Well, today I'm going to share with you my idea at this point, and where I'm at with it, and why I think this could be, well, a pretty big trade. First of all, this is totally educational advice. It's my opinion, like belly buttons. We all got an opinion, right? We all got a belly button. So my whole thing is, I look at all markets. I look at stocks, I look at bonds, the derivatives markets, currency, and I believe you should be able to play in some way on each platform to an extent. Now, currency and derivatives, in particular a certain type of derivative, is out of my league. And I want to know more about it. I want to educate myself on it. But right now, what I do understand and what I do know is the stock and bond market. And I'm starting to understand one part of the derivatives market more and more. But what I've gotten to thinking about is this whole recovery from COVID from a year ago. Today is March 12th of 2021. A year ago, our country was shut down, our world was shut down, and people started to lose jobs. We were in a panic, and we started seeing all markets sell off. And in particular, the bond market in treasuries, and we saw stocks sell off. And we've just seen this massive drawdown until March 23rd, when everything started to recalibrate and reorganize to an extent. And we, at that point, we saw the move into the treasury market because the Fed started buying treasuries at a rapid rate. Their balance sheet expanded at a rapid rate. And stocks that had gotten annihilated in the early part of March started to rebound. And so a lot of those stocks were the tech stocks, and a lot of commodities were ignored. And the US dollar basically was really high in comparison to commodity prices, and commodity prices were real low. And so that big trade in the commodity world, in lumber and oil and gas, started to materialize back in June of last year. And I sort of missed it. I didn't put it all together at the time. And what we saw was, and what we have seen, is the commodity market has exploded. If you are have bought a piece of lumber in the last 6 months, you know you've paid an enormous more in price than you have as of a year ago. So lumber costs have gone up, and it's that dollar commodity relation. And if you had identified it and you had capitalized on it and you had leveraged it, well, you've made a ton of money. Well, I believe we're coming into another possible big trade, and that big trade is in treasuries, in bonds in particular. Yes, bonds. See, bonds have been on a 40-year bull run up until recently. 40 years. If 40 years ago you had put your money into 10-year treasuries in 1980, I believe it was August 17th of 1980, you would be making a yield of 15.25%. Now, as we all know, bonds and prices are inverse. Like a teeter-totter, you and your buddy are on the playground, and in like a teeter-totter, and the yield goes up, bond values go down, and when the yield goes down, bond values go up. Well, for 40 straight years, we have seen a consistent rise in bond values and a falling in yield overall. Well, I believe, as we have seen yields rise here recently, just checked on my screen, and the 10-year is trading at about 1.54% yield. So it has gone up since the bottoming of the COVID situation, where with a 10-year yield got down to, I believe, between 0.54 and 0.64. It's in between there somewhere. So that means that yield went down really far and that bond value went up. Well, what's happened since then? People have exited bonds. They have risk on. They've gone to the tech. They've gone to other types of in stock type investments. Even the speculators have jumped in on, you know, heavily high shorted stock positions like GameStop and AMC. And we're seeing that all materialize. In the meantime, we've seen growth on an economic level in the United States and really globally start to ramp back up. Inflation has started to ramp back up, and we're seeing that rise. And monetary policy overall has been very accommodating. Cheap money, keeping interest rates low, and really encouraging the risk on go out and spend, revamp our economy, and get it going again kind of attitude from the Federal Reserve and just Treasury in general. Well, here's my thinking. My idea starts with a spike in growth, a spike in inflation, which I believe we're in the midst of, and because of other circumstances, that abruptly ends. And it ends possibly sometime second half of this year. So third quarter 2021, fourth quarter 2021, going into first quarter 2022. Here's why I think this growth phase, this expansion ends. Number one, the cost of goods to manufacture and supply. As you all know, supply chains have been interrupted in the last year. I heard a month ago or so, Ford was stopping the production of the Ford F-150 because of the lack of chips that control your cars now are unavailable. I'm looking to buy a new mountain bike, and I just found out, I've known this for a while, that there is a shortage of high-end mountain bikes in the United States. And I just heard that Santa Cruz bikes are increasing their retail costs on their bikes because of this shortage. They're getting more money, they're making more profit, I get it. But man, when you want something and you can't get it, I mean, I was listening to a lady who's an interior decorator, and she said they're so short on the amount of couches, sleeper couches, you know, the couches you pull out and it sleeps as a bed. There is a shortage of them, and the reason being is production got set back because of COVID, and so that shortage of supply has driven the cost of couches up, and people who want to decorate are having to wait 3, 4, 5 months to get their furniture because it's so backward. So supply of goods to manufacture goods for us to buy is tight, and when there's not a lot of supply, the cost of those goods go up. And maybe at some point it gets out of reach for the, well, for us, the consumer. The second reason I believe that we're going to see an abrupt stop to the economy expanding is because of labor and lack of it. Now, what do I mean by that? There's plenty of people to work, right? Unemployment numbers are starting to drop. We're seeing that happen. But here's the thing. When you get a check in the mail, or you get weekly unemployment checks, what's your incentive to go back to work, right? I mean, there's plenty of people looking for people to work right now, but people are incentivized to work because checks are being written from our federal government. This whole $1.9 trillion stimulus package, number one, littered with junk in it, but what it's doing is it's putting money in people's pockets, and it's encouraging them not to work. Yeah, you fill out the unemployment applications, and yeah, maybe blah, 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 but do you ever show up for the interview? Do you accept the job when you're getting money in the mailbox? No. And that's why I believe we get to third quarter and all of a sudden, quarter after quarter, earnings numbers in comparison, profit numbers in comparison, year after year comparisons are starting to go over that top of that bell curve. And I believe that all of a sudden shocks the environment, the economy, the stock market, bond market, every market. And all of a sudden we go from growth, rising inflation, hawkish monetary policy to recession, declining growth, declining inflation, and concern or dovish kind of a policy within our federal government, Fed, Treasury, that kind of thing. And I believe we head back into a recession. Well, what works in a recession? When you are scared, where do you go? Well, you go to a safe place. Maybe you go in your house, you lock all the doors, you go into a room, you lock all the doors. Maybe you have a safe place in your house where it's locked down. Well, in markets, it's the same thing. And that same thing, that safe place, is bonds. And in particular, U.S. Treasuries. Now, Treasuries have gone up in yield, values are going down, and if you're in bonds over the last 3-4 months, you're losing money. A lot of people who have 401k plans and they're in bonds, they're seeing a decline in their bond values, and unless their stock portfolios are, or equity portfolios are more aggressive to offset that, they're starting to see sort of a topping in their portfolios. What I believe can happen and will happen is that we will see bad numbers, economic numbers, in the second half of this year, bleeding into the first half of next year, and those numbers will be disconcerting, and markets will start to pull back, and you'll see a sellout of equities and a move back into risk-off assets like bonds, in particular, the 10-year bond, the 30-year bond. I mean, by that time, you most likely will see close to 3% on the 30-year treasury. You most likely will see 1.8 to 1.2% on the 10-year treasury. I mean, we're just right around the corner on this one. Well, what happens when money floods into a bond? The yields go down and the values go up. And if my theory happens and comes to fruition, that could be a big move in the 10-year from that high end of 1.92% yield back down under 1%. Now, this is where allocation really comes into play. It's the anticipation of it. It's building into the trade. And this is only a trade. This is not a long-term investment. This is a trade. Like I said, I want one of those trades. George Soros had it with, and Jim Rogers had it with shorting the British pound. Michael Burry had it with the housing crash. A lot of great trades have been made over time, but they build and the theories build over time. I mean, I think Michael Burry, who shorted the housing market and became famous in The Big Short for it, built that trade out over 4 years. This one I don't think is that far out. But I do believe there's some great opportunity in this trade, and it's only a trade. How do I position for it? How do I know when this thing is ready to go? When to over-allocate into this, overweight my trade position? Well, a couple of things. What I believe you'll see is economic numbers will start to weaken again. That's a sign. When we start to see the index, stock indexes, hit lower highs and lower lows consistently over a weekly period of time. So as we see the higher lows and lower lows on like the S&P, the Dow, the NASDAQ, over beyond 3 weeks in time, the trend is broken. We're starting to see a weakening in that equity market environment. That is a signal to me. The rise in the US dollar, where countries start to exchange their treasuries for US dollars, like we saw back in March of 2020. As we see these numbers start to happen, this is when I believe I'm building my plan for my trade, and now I start to implement it in little pieces, because if I'm wrong, I don't want to be all in and get wiped out. Rather, I want to add little pieces, maybe half a basis point at a time of my portfolio to this. At no time am I ever 100% this trade. It's a good way to be in out of business, right? But a bigger allocation to this idea. And as this idea comes to fruition and we see the market make that move, I start to add to it and I build a bigger and bigger position. And as momentum picks up in this trade, I'll add more and more to it, leveraging more into it so I can really make it work. And then at some point before the top, I start to get out, because it's sort of like a fire at a movie theater. There's one door and everybody tries to get out at once. Whereas if you see a little smoke or smell a little smoke in the theater, you exit before everybody else does. And that's my plan. Now, will this come about in the next 6 months? Will it come about in the next year? I don't know, but this is the trade I'm looking for. I'm looking for that. Meanwhile, I'm still allocated to my commodity exposure, some tech exposure, more small cap, more looking at the retail market, those areas where the market is doing well and I am making money right now. But this is the trade. This is the one that, who knows, 10 years from now, look back and go, somebody asks you, what was your big trade? I'll say this. This was my big trade. Long treasuries, long bonds, long risk-off assets, and took advantage of an opportunity. I think like anything when it comes to investing, you don't just jump in and do it. You plan it out. You think through it. You just don't go out and boom, 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 like we're seeing a lot of people with the high shorted stocks here recently. You do your homework. This is where it pays off. And if you look at some of the biggest money managers, hedge fund investors, traders in the world, they have a process, and part of that process is patience and building a theory and then working that theory and back testing that theory and then building a plan to implement in that to that theory. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But in the end, it's fun and it's about the adventure of building it and getting there. It's not always the end result, it's the adventure. So as you proceed throughout your day and you start to look at things, think about what is happening here globally. Where could your big trade be coming from? And how do you position for it? And how do you plan it out? Good luck. That's my idea. And right now it's an idea and I'm working the idea. I'll keep you up to date on my idea as we get closer and closer and as it develops. In the meantime, have a great day, live loud, and always be on an adventure.